Buongiorno a tutti, sono Claudio Giua, sono il direttore dello sviluppo e innovazione del Gruppo Espresso e per me è un grande onore oggi brevissimamente introdurre Matthew Ingram. Matthew Ingram è uno dei giornalisti che riescono a fare del futuro un panorama che diventa, come dire, per tutti noi comprensibile ed accettabile. Matthew Ingram ha cominciato come giornalista economico, ha lavorato in vari giornali di varie dimensioni in Canada, è canadese, vive a Toronto. Dopo molti anni di questo lavoro, all'inizio del nuovo millennio, cioè una dozzina di anni fa, è passato a lavorare al sito del Globe and Mail, che è il più importante giornale in lingua inglese canadese. Lì ha cominciato a trattare non solo dal punto di vista del sito, ma anche scrivendo sui giornali di problemi legati al web, al digitale, eccetera, e è diventato in pochi anni una delle voci più importanti, secondo me, secondo il mio giudizio, la più importante voce di analisi e di comprensione, che ci consente la comprensione dei fenomeni. Personalmente, proprio un giornalista di una categoria che mi fa, come dire, arrabbiare, perché mi capita spesso che mentre io ancora sto cercando di formulare le mie domande, cercare di capire quale domande fare per capire il fenomeno, Matthew se ne esca con un articolo dove mi dà già le risposte. Questo ovviamente ti fa sentire un po' stupido, perché dici: ma come, io ancora devo capire dove siamo e lui già mi dà la risposta che mi fa andare così avanti. E questo lo fa oggi per un importantissimo sito che forse voi conoscete, che si chiama GigaOm, che è stato fondato alcuni anni fa da O'Malik, e che adesso, qualche tempo fa, ha anche inglobato un altro sito molto importante, che è Paid Content. Quindi, se voi andate su paidcontent.com o gigaom.com, trovate tutti i suoi articoli che sono sotto il suo nome, li trovate tutti riuniti. E tra questi troverete, per esempio, mi sono segnato alcuni degli ultimi articoli che ha scritto negli ultimi giorni. È molto prolifico, Matthew, anzi. Mi raccontava prima che recentemente un suo amico e collega gli ha detto: mi metti in difficoltà perché scrivi troppo spesso e scrivi troppe cose, io devo leggerle tutte perché sono obbligato a leggere per capire qualcosa, e probabilmente se tu allentassi un po' il ritmo sarebbe meglio. Ha scritto delle cose che a me particolarmente interessano molto, in particolare ha scritto un articolo molto importante qualche giorno fa sul fenomeno del cosiddetto brand journalism, cioè il giornalismo che è legato direttamente alle aziende e che probabilmente creerà nei prossimi anni il maggior numero di posti di lavoro anche per i giornalisti. Quindi lo dico ai molti ragazzi che sono qui che vogliono fare questo mestiere, perché il brand journalism non è niente di vergognoso, non vuol dire fare un lavoro dalla parte dei brand, dalla parte delle aziende, vuol dire fare informazione, semplicemente anziché farlo organismi, chiamiamoli indipendenti, viene fatto direttamente dalle aziende, ma questo non vuol dire che non possa essere un giornalismo di buona qualità a tutti gli effetti. Questi e tanti altri argomenti sono il pane quotidiano di Matthew. Quindi io lascerei immediatamente la parola a lui, ha una presentazione credo molto visuale. Quello che è importante è che alla fine del suo intervento, perché così si aspetta, me l'ha proprio ripetuto, si aspetta le vostre domande. Quindi il più possibile preparatevi domande, anche brevissime, e Matthew sarà felicissimo di rispondere. Grazie.
Grazie. Grazie. Buongiorno. Good morning. How are you all doing? Good? Those are all the languages I know, by the way. That last one was American. Can you pull up the slide? I'd like to apologize just in advance. I just got here yesterday, and so part of my brain still thinks it's 5:30 in the morning. So if anything goes wrong, just please ignore it or call the authorities or whatever. So I'm going to go through this as quickly as I can, and then hopefully we can get to some questions, because I think that's often the most, I enjoy my slides, but I think questions are often the best part of a presentation. So I'm going to go as quickly as I can. So the first thing I think, and I should note, this presentation is called Five Things Old Media Can Learn from New Media. Obviously, there are things that new media can learn from old media as well, but that's a whole different presentation. So, and the subtitle, How to Teach the Fish to Walk, comes from a conversation I had with an editor of mine when I worked at a newspaper. And I told him, you know, all we really need to do is evolve and change the way we're doing things. And he said, evolve, you mean like fish grew legs? And so I said, yes, exactly. We just need to teach our fish how to walk, which as it turns out to be harder than you might think. So the first thing I think old media can learn from new media is how to be open. And by that I mean, to a lot of people, I think that traditional media, whether it's newspapers or magazines or television, looks a lot like this. It's a very nice building, but it's a fortress. So it has huge high walls, nothing much gets in, people behind those walls are doing things you're not too sure what they're doing. Periodically something comes out from the main door, you never see anyone. That's sort of a typical metaphor for what newspapers used to look like and to some extent still look like. Impenetrable, inhuman. I think to a lot of other people, traditional media looks like this, and I realize this looks very much like what I'm doing right now, which is awkward, but so this is another view of what media used to do. Delivering a message from on high, preaching, if you will. We talk, you listen, and that's what media consists of. I think for the most part, there hasn't really been much back and forth between journalists and their audience. And I think that's been a result of the way that media was structured. It's very difficult to respond to a newspaper article unless you own your own newspaper. You can call the switchboard, you can grab someone as they walk out, and that's about the only feedback you get. But I think now we have so many more ways of interacting as journalists. Obviously, there's new social tools coming up every day. This is an old version of my social graph. I think my friend Luca Conti might even be in here somewhere. This was from a number of years ago. But we have all the tools we want. And I think one of the interesting things Clay Shirky said, one of the things I hate about Clay Shirky is that he comes up with phrases that I wish I had come up with. And so he said, publishing is no longer an industry, it's a button. So everyone now has the ability to publish. They can publish tweets, they can publish Facebook posts, they can publish blogs, they can publish newspapers, they can publish whatever they want. Those tools are no longer ours alone as journalists. And that fundamentally changes the relationship. I think all we have to do if we want to improve our journalism is to ask people for help. We have so many tools now, and those tools aren't just for transmitting our journalism. They aren't just for promoting our content. They're for interaction. And my test for what a journalist is doing now is how much of that interaction they do. And the less they do, I think the poorer journalist they are. That's my belief. I think lots of times people will provide things that you could never imagine. This is my favorite graphic for Twitter. Twitter obviously is only one tool. There are lots of other ways to get feedback from people. And I think everyone wants to feel like they have something to contribute. Everyone wants to feel like they have something that they can offer. And in many cases, they do. These people are what Dan Gilmore called the people formerly known as the audience. So in the past, the audience was much like you are here, sitting, listening, receiving. But that audience has become, has the ability now to interact and publish along with journalists. And I think that changes the nature of that relationship to multi-directional instead of just unidirectional. Sometimes people know things that we don't know, things that are useful, things that are important. How do we help them tell us those things? How many ways can we give them to let us know the things that they know about the stories we're writing? That, to me, is the core of what these tools allow. They allow you to do better journalism by contacting people who know things you don't. And that's the fundamental problem of journalism. You're writing about something, you need to know something. There is someone out there who knows that thing. And this is a way for you to find them. So number one, be more open. This is a quote from Alan Rusbridger, the editor-in-chief of The Guardian, and he described his view of open journalism, a journalism that is itself responsive, a journalism that doesn't just sit on the web as though there's no connection with the web. And you can produce better things by not ignoring it and by not building a barrier between yourself and that. And obviously there's a fundamental tension here, which maybe we can talk later, Claudio and I and you, about the tension between that vision of open journalism and paywalls, because there's quite clearly a tension there. So the first thing is to be open. The second thing old media can learn from new media is to give credit. And what do I mean by that? What's the most fundamental aspect of publishing online? I think the most fundamental aspect is the hyperlink. Obviously, HTML and all those tools, that's what allows us to publish online. But this is the fundamental aspect of what publishing what makes publishing online different from publishing in print. You can't put a link in a print article. And I think the nature of the link is it allows you to give credit to the people who provided information that you are using in your story or your journalism. And it also allows you to support your argument. I actually have as an old-time journalist, print journalist who converted sort of to digital, I now read things, if they don't have links, I start to question that thing. Obviously not if it's in print, but if it's online and there are no links in it, to me it is a lower form of journalism. There has to be at least one link. There has to be at least one thing that that writer used in their reporting or a source or some other article that they were reading. There has to be something that they used that they should tell me about. Because what if I want to go and find out more information about that thing? Those are the things that you should be providing inside that story. It supports your argument. It supports your credibility. And particularly, if we're talking about a new multi-directional journalism, if you are using other sources, you have to give credit to those sources. You have to provide them the thing that everyone online needs most, which is links from other places that say, this is valuable. And if we can't give people any of this, then at least we can give them a link. At least we can give them a mention on Twitter, for example. At least we could retweet them. It's a form of gratitude, in a way, because we all rely on other people, other information that we found. Nothing comes purely from our own brains. And I think providing credit allows us to show that. So it's a simple thing. I think we forget about the power of links. But we can't operate like a walled garden. We can't pretend that all the things we generate inside that impenetrable fortress are the only things that are of value. And I think this is something that it was a fight. It's becoming less of a fight. But I used to have to argue that our stories should include links. And I had to continually defend, well, why would we want to link to someone else? Why would we want to link to one of our competitors? And my point was, because people are going to read it, and if there isn't a link, they're going to start wondering, well, why? Why didn't you link to that thing? I read this other thing that was about that topic, and you didn't link to it. Which either means you didn't see it, or it means you didn't feel that it was worthwhile linking to, which means you think you're the only one that has important information. What's the third thing? The third thing, I think, is how to be more human. And this is sort of a controversial topic, I guess. I mean, I like to believe journalists are human. I know that many of my friends who are journalists like to believe journalists are human, but journalists have had a sort of reputation. The professionalism has sort of been raised above the humanism, the human nature of journalists. And so I think it's okay once in a while to admit that we fail, to admit that we made a mistake. It's okay to admit that we're not superhuman. It's okay to admit that we have flaws and that every now and then we slip up. And I think that's something that's very difficult for journalists to admit. It's certainly difficult for me to admit. I would rather pretend that I never make a mistake. And I know that newspapers in particular like to pretend that they never make mistakes. So the corrections to stories are always you know, tiny print on page 50, hoping that no one will notice that you made a mistake. I think sometimes you have to come out and admit that you made a mistake. Just that is something that's human. And I would argue, this is a whole nother debate, but I would argue some people would claim that that makes readers trust you less if you admit that you were wrong. I think it makes them trust you more. Because if you met someone who claimed that they never made a mistake, what would you think? I would think they were a psychopath or they were a liar. Everyone makes mistakes. So if you're trying to complain that you, or if you're trying to claim that you never make a mistake, I think most people are just not going to believe you. And I think in many cases, readers will show more trust because they connect with you as a human being. That's something that social media is incredibly good at. It's incredibly good at breaking down the barriers between journalists as individuals and everyone else as individuals. And obviously there is a risk there. And we could go into lots of detail, I'm sure, about journalists who have maybe been a little too human on Twitter, for example, and gotten into trouble. And that is definitely a risk. But I think that's, you can't get the benefits of a social technology without being social. And that means being human. So number three is to be more human. The fourth thing I think that new media does that old media has not been good at is to see journalism and the news as a process instead of an artifact. So in the old days, you would just, news was very much an industrial product. You had people who would assemble something and then they would pass it along an assembly line to an editor and they would sort of tighten a few bolts and then it would go further and another editor would tweak some things and then you would punch out this finished product and you would deliver it to people at their houses or on the street, and that was your job, a very industrial sort of process. I think, you know, you would write down what people say, spit it out onto dead trees. Now the news has no beginning and end. That sort of structure, that the industrial process, was created because of the technology. It wasn't because that's how the news works. Everyone who's ever experienced a news event of any kind knows that it has no real beginning or end. It may have a sharply defined point at which something happens, a bomb goes off. But there's lots more to that story. And that industrial process doesn't show you the before and after. It assumes that this story is this discrete thing that you can wrap up in a nice, neat little package. And I think one of the things that the web does very well, and that social media does very well, is give the impression of how news actually works, which is it's constant, it's ongoing. Stories ebb and flow, and new information comes in, and you have to update things, and then readers contribute, and you assemble those things. That's a stream. It's not a sort of a product that you create and punch out and deliver to people. And the people who can produce that news come from anywhere. The people who can be involved in the news, who generate important information, can contribute from anywhere. And that sort of industrialized process doesn't take account of that very well. We have to incorporate that somehow in what we do and give readers some direction. I think what journalists do fundamentally is, whether it's in print or online, is to make sense of things for people. And I think that's a answer questions. And readers go and find their own information if you're not providing it in the way that they want. So I think that whether the tools have changed or not, the fundamental skills are the same. Filtering, curating, aggregating, making sense of verifying information, and then packaging that in ways that make sense to people. So number four is news as a process. And the fifth thing I think that old media can learn from new media is how to focus. And by focus, I mean focusing on specific things that you understand or do well or have a connection with readers around. So the traditional newspaper was just a way of aggregating everything, a way of taking in as much content as possible. So sports, entertainment, lifestyle, news, business. So that the newspaper is not a specialized product. there are newspapers that are known for certain things, but in lots of ways, the sort of mass market newspaper is an anomaly. You now, readers want, if they want to read about entertainment, they will go to a website that is specifically about entertainment. If they want to read about football, they have sites that are specifically about that. They don't have to go to this all-in-one sort of news aggregator. And in a lot of cases, that focus comes from the relationship that you have with those readers. That's what focus gives you. And I think every day people are overwhelmed with so much information. There's so much that they need to filter through. And there's so much choice, obviously, of places they could go, information they could get, about all the things they want. So we need to provide a way for them to understand the world. Everywhere people are searching for information that matters to them. In this case, the droids. And I think as journalists, it's our job to help them find that information. And to the extent that we do that, then we develop a valuable relationship with them. And that value extends beyond just, you know, their friendship or their loyalty into monetization and so on, which is, again, a whole nother topic. And I think if we're prepared to listen, they will help us do that. They, as I said before, they have so many more tools now that allow them to do that, allow them to help us do that job for them. And in the end, I think it's not really about selling more newspapers, distributing more product. It's about what we can tell people about the world around them in ways that matter to them. So number five is how to focus. And these are them in order. Be more open, give credit, be more human, see news as a process, and be more focused. And that's all I have. I'd love to take some questions from Claudio or from you and talk about any of this or any of the other things that you want to talk about that I didn't mention. Shall we sit?
Oh, okay. Oh, okay. Ecco, se avete domande, prego. Ecco, Matthew ha la traduzione, quindi se volete...
No, I think I will
okay, that's good.
Ask
okay.
In English directly.
Okay.
Thank you for the presentation, sir. So I would like to start from the last topic, which was to be focused.
Focus.
And to me, the future of... I mean, I work as a public relations officer, so I deal with journalists almost every day. My understanding is that... the idea I have of the future of newspapers, at least, is I'm going to wake up in the morning and I'm going to download from my tablet the latest issue, which is going to be extremely focused to right. My personal interests.
Right.
So it's like I'm going to ask my my favorite brand, the New York Times, Washington Post, you name it, to deliver every morning a paper which is tailored around me. Mm-hmm. So no baseball news, only basketball, no foreign politics. I'm not interested in Syria, let's say. Lots of economy and maybe some local news. Do you think this is really going to happen? Are traditional media prepared to be more focused? Because to my feeling is that they are a bit worried because it's a way to show that some journalists, some desks are more important to others mm-hmm. than others because some topics are more popular mm-hmm. to others. So some editorial desks are actually more newsworthy, more
right.
are driving more revenues
right.
if. The new model is going to be like the one I've just tell you. So I'd like
sure.
to say what's your point, what's your opinion on this?
And I think one problem is that newspapers in particular don't really know their readers very well. I mean, they know them in aggregate. So you know, say, you have this many readers between these ages and maybe you know that they are more interested in this or that, but you don't know individual readers. So that type of personalization that you're talking about is very difficult unless you know that person or group of people. And that's something that online media is more adapted to. So newspapers have never really, you know, you just publish the newspaper and you drop it off somewhere and people read it, and that's your business. So that getting to know people so that you can personalize is one of the issues, I think, for traditional media. The other aspect of what you're describing is the risk, I think. There are two risks. One is what Eli Pariser calls the filter bubble. So if you have a hyper-personalized newspaper and you don't read any foreign news, maybe you stop knowing about things that are actually important to you in the world, and you lose connection with the sort of broader population or society. That's a risk. The other risk is that you become so focused on the specific things that you're already interested in, you don't get exposed to anything new. You sort of stick with the things that you already agree with or the people you already agree with. And the other issue for newspapers and media companies is if everyone chooses sports and entertainment, the things that actually make money, who pays for the other stuff? Who pays for the investigative journalism or foreign reporting or, you know, the things that are boring and that no one puts their hand up and says, I really want to read a long article about this boring tax thing, but that is actually important. How do you do that? Anyway, good question. Thank you.
I think that surprise was one of the most important features.
Serendipity.
Of newspapers. Mm-hmm. You just watch your newspaper and find a lot of different things that you wouldn't know anyway. So it's
lots of things you don't want too, though.
That's very please.
I'm a journalist from Japan. I have one question, which is, do you think the journalism as a profession will cease to exist in the future? I'm not talking about the existence of journalism, but journalism as a profession where people can make money to support their lives, because when you think about the birth of journalism in Europe, maybe in Britain, I think it was the 17th century. So in terms of centuries, do you think the existence of journalism is going to disappear as a profession?
Wow, thank you. That's a really tough question. I hope not. I mean, I hope there will always be people who make money as journalists, are employed as journalists. I think it's a tremendously important skill. I do think that it's being broadened now. So I think, you know, my belief is that the skills that make someone a journalist and the way they apply those is actually anyone can do that. That's not to say anyone will do that, but anyone can do that. You don't have to go to a specific school. You don't have to work for a specific company. You just have to have those skills and that drive. Whether you get paid for doing it or not, I mean, you could ask the same thing about writing. So authors writing books, is that going to be a profession? If you go back far enough, and I know sitting in this room encourages me to think back, you know, 600, 700, 800 years, there have always been people who do those things. They just haven't always been, it hasn't always been a profession. It hasn't always been, that's all you do. In some cases, it was something you did because you enjoyed it. And I think we're seeing a lot more, whether it's, you know, art or culture or writing, or now there are so many more ways to do that, even if you don't get paid. So I think all that does for professional journalists is raise the bar. You know, there are people doing for free the thing that you're now getting paid for. So you had better try harder. Yes, Luca.
Give us some suggestions, some tips about your information diet.
I guess my number one tip would be find more hours in the day. I get asked this question all the time. I don't have a strategy, really. I don't have, I'm constantly sort of, it's just washing over me all the time. So I have TweetDeck with 6 or 7 different streams, different lists, different topics, different breaking news or whatever. I have 40, 50 tabs open in my browser. You know, it's just a constant. So that stream that I, that image I had of the waves washing over you is what happens to me every day. And the hard part, obviously, is finding the things that are valuable in that. And that's a struggle for me as much as for anyone. I have tools. So Prismatic is something I use. Does anybody use Prismatic? Okay, Luca and me. Okay, and you. It's early days for tools like that, ones that try and algorithmically sort through things for you. And all of them are flawed, but they do have value in sort of cutting through the noise. And there's also, interestingly enough, Prismatic has a kind of serendipity engine, if you will, that tries to randomize a little bit so that it doesn't just become all the things that you're already interested in reading about. And that is that's a struggle. I don't want to just get locked into this one specific view of things either. So I'm always looking for, there are actually people I follow on Twitter who are what I call serendipity engines for me. So people who are outside of my normal sphere, or they have interests that are outside of mine. And I know that they're going to show me things that I would not otherwise come across. So, Steve.
The things you said, Matthew, several of the things, you know, the openness and the focus and the process kind of require changing how we think or how we work.
Mm-hmm.
The being more human or admitting we're more human gets into an area of ethics that for a lot of journalists, being objective, mm-hmm. being kind of the opposite of human, is kind of the core of our identity as journalists. Talk a little bit about the ethical challenges and issues of being more human.
It's a huge, huge topic. I mean, we could probably spend hours just talking about that, because it is a fundamental difference in seeing, in the way you see what you do. You know, if your view of what a journalist was goes back sort of more to the fortress image, you're just a person inside that institution. You're not actually, the human part of you isn't that important. It's your ability as an objective, you know, engine for sort of collating facts and distributing things that's more important. To me, I believe that there is value in having the human part of a journalist be more a part of what they do. And obviously that depends on what you see as your job. If you're covering the mayor and the mayor's office, you know, expressing loudly your opinions about the mayor's intelligence, you know, or good looks or whatever, it could have an impact on how you do your job. That's something that you always have to think about. But to me, I'm not sure I would go as far as those who argue that transparency is the new objectivity, but I believe that transparency does go a long way to sort of mitigating the issues that can come with allowing journalists to express opinions. So the fact that, for example, the New York Times journalism bureau chief expressed opinions on Twitter about the Middle East, I think is a good thing. If she didn't have opinions about the Middle East, then I think she should be fired. I mean, why is that person even in that job? So provided they're sort of intelligent, thoughtful opinions, then I don't understand why you can't allow that person to express them. She actually had her own social media editor who would, you know, check her tweets before they went out. I think that's farcical. If that person if you hired them because they're intelligent and they're interested in that topic, it is difficult, because the more opinions you express, the more people you're going to irritate. But I think that is part of what we do now, whether we like it or not. And so we need to find a way to figure it out. Yes.
Hello. It's partly connected to what you just said. I just wanted to have some more insights about the way that new media are changing the agenda setting process and the stakeholders of this old media, maybe concept agenda setting. For example, till a few months ago, when I woke up in the morning, the first thing I would do is to check my newspaper or my iPad. But now I find myself first checking my Twitter to see what my journalists, my favorite writers, or my favorite connections talk about. Mm-hmm. I found what what newspapers talk about now pretty boring. They all talk about that, the same things.
That's a really interesting point. I think a lot of people are probably in the same position as you. They used to look to the newspaper front page, or they used to look to the, you know, anchor on their local news to tell them what was important. And now it's much more your social network, much more the sources that you choose deliberately to listen to. I know I had a discussion with an editor at our newspaper when I worked there. He said he was interested in what my front page was. He said, "What's your front page on the internet?" Because he was comparing it to the front page of the newspaper. And I said, "I don't have a front page. I don't go to," he was thinking maybe I use Google News or Yahoo News, or I said, "I don't go to any of those places. I go to Twitter and I go to websites that write about things I'm interested in. So I don't have a front page." And so there's nothing that plays that role anymore. And that brings up a whole bunch of issues. One is, let's say you have goes back to the sort of filter bubble question. If you're following a specific group of people, or you're only looking at, say, Twitter trending topics, are you going to miss things that are important that just haven't hit your sort of sphere or your social circle? And how do you, I mean, some people may not see any problem with that. My argument about the filter bubble was always, we've always had that problem. There have always been people who only watch CNN or only watch Fox News or only read one newspaper, or in fact only read one person in that newspaper and allow that person to tell them what's important. So we've always had that problem. I think if you want to, now you have the ability to be exposed to so many more different viewpoints. But the secret is you have to want to.
Well, if you were called by a publisher, and these publishers ask you, "I have two chances for you. The first one is an old newspaper, but a very established brand, very mm-hmm. important, and I need to change it. And I have the chance to be the editor in chief of something completely new with no brand. What do you prefer?"
Wow. I guess in a way I've already had that choice to make. I mean, I left an established newspaper where I had a great job, and I started something brand new at GigaOM. I didn't start it, but I joined this brand new thing. I think when I joined, there might have been a dozen people. But I mean, myself, there's definitely value in old brands and in old. I mean, I'm a huge fan of lots of traditional newspapers, and they have a very, very, very hard job ahead of them, and I don't envy anyone who is doing that. I was much more interested in trying things that are new, and newspapers, to be honest, no offense, they're not good at that. That's not something that for 50, 60, 100 years, newspapers just pretty much did the same thing. That's not something that's going to make it easy for you to just try new things. And there are newspapers that are trying new things, but I think it's easier when you don't have this sort of giant traditional business sort of looming over you.
Here. You five think, or at least one or two, that old media can teach new media. Thank you.
I knew someone was going to ask me that question. I should pick the right two. I should pick the right ones. I think an interest in accuracy is one. So I think new media, and we saw this recently with the Boston bombings and Hurricane Sandy and the shootings in Connecticut and pretty much every breaking news event, the focus new media is addicted to speed, so the faster the better. And you could argue, and I have argued, that the corrections eventually happen, that better information eventually displaces worse information. But I think one of the things that old media has done well is focus on getting the story right as opposed to getting it quickly. And that's a balance, obviously, that you constantly have to strike. New media is much more interested in just being first. And so that's something that maybe patience is something that old media could teach new media. I think the other thing is just a sort of respect for, I don't want to say tradition, but history, you know, the established traditions of doing things. Some of those do have value. Not everything needs to be destroyed. Not everything needs to be exploded or disrupted. And so there are things of value that we need to bring forward into the new ways of doing things. So that's two. I hope that will do.
Posso fare una domanda? Io la ringrazio per la presentazione, molto... Ok. La ringrazio per la presentazione, molto interessante. Le vorrei porre questo quesito che mi ponevo mentre lei parlava. Come giovane che ha deciso di fare questo lavoro, io frequento il festival per capire...
Can you translate for me? It's not working. Sorry, go ahead.
I have to speak English.
Channel? Yeah. Which channel? One? Okay.
Okay, posso? Okay.
Go ahead.
Mentre parlava mi chiedevo questo. Come giovane che ha deciso di fare questo lavoro, io sto cercando di capire quali sono le competenze che, come ha detto la giornalista giapponese, mi consentiranno di campare con questo lavoro. Una cosa che ho capito è che i new media sono fondamentali. Durante il festival stiamo parlando di tutti gli aspetti: Twitter, Facebook, conoscere gli strumenti foto, video, gli strumenti online. Poi però arrivo a cercare questo tipo di lavoro e mi scontro con una realtà. Le redazioni online pagano meno di quelle cartacee, il mondo dell'informazione web non riesce ad autofinanziarsi con gli spazi pubblicitari come invece riesce a fare la carta. Allora le chiedo, secondo lei questo è un problema solo italiano e se secondo lei un giorno queste competenze che io adesso ho capito che devo acquisire verranno pagate da qualcuno? Grazie.
Wow. Again, that's a huge issue. I mean, it's actually not the case that all online media pay less than traditional media. For example, we pay as much or more as a traditional media outlet. But it is the case that many do. And again, there's the issue that I mentioned before, that people are doing for free the thing that you want to get paid for. So I think the only challenge, it's more than just the tool. It's more than just whether you do good video or you have a Twitter account with lots of followers. I don't think those things are the things that will allow you to get paid. I think the thing that you have to do is just be the best possible journalist about whatever it is you're writing about, and just constantly think to yourself, there are people out there doing in their spare time for nothing the thing that I want to get paid for. So how do I do what they're doing but better? And how do I find, to me, the secret, if there is one, to monetization or getting paid or any of those business model questions is, have you connected with you, either you personally or the thing you work for? Have you connected with a specific audience, and are they passionately interested in what you are writing about. And if you can find that relationship, you can make money somehow.
I have a question about your presentation.
Yes.
You said old media should give more credit, like new media does, but on the internet, it's a technical advantage to link to everything you want and still have a text that is readable. But if a newspaper does that, it's hardly readable, the article, if you put so many links in there. So how can old media give that much credit and still be good to read?
That's a good question. I know I've gotten criticized for putting too many links in my blog posts, which I find just a sort of bizarre problem to have with someone, but because my problem is the opposite. I don't think enough people put links in, so I kind of overcompensate. In fact, my own daughter complained at one point that there were too many links in my blog post and that it was too much like reading a Wikipedia entry. I like to go too far and put too many in because I think you never know to... I would just like them to include a few. You know, I don't care if there's 15 or 20. I don't care if, you know, every sixth word is a link. I would just like them to include some. So then the question of how many comes down to, you know, there's a whole subtopic. Nick Carr, I think, wrote about what he called the cognitive sort of friction of having links. If there's too many links, his argument was that confuses readers because they sort of trip over the links. To be honest, I think that's ridiculous. I don't think anybody is going to not read something because there's too many links. But I could be wrong, obviously. It's just my sort of default is to include them just in case people might want them. Sometimes I actually include links to interesting things just because I'm interested in them. And I think maybe one or two readers will click on that and go and find it and be as interested as I was. I don't know if that answers your question. Yes.
Yeah, sure. I'm Jussi Pullin from Helsingin Sanomat. We're a newspaper or a paper aggregator in Helsinki, Finland. So my question is, you talked about news as a process. Even though we have a huge audience and we do both. We do like live coverage on Twitter and live blogging and et cetera. And we do actually the regular wrap-ups. And we do see a huge demand for the wrap-ups that you actually said that aren't needed. And I think we saw some of that in Boston as well when people got tired of the Twitter, I'm sorry, failing at reporting what's happening. And
right.
Then they sort of went for the wrap-ups that Boston Globe did very well. So my question in short is, do you think that newspapers or huge media organizations should try to do it all, sort of be the first, do it quick, report it, or just hold back and then bring a wrap-up or an authoritative voice to the conversation? Sort of, do you
that's a really good question. Obviously, there's a temptation to do everything, and I think if you are a newspaper or a traditional news entity, you have sort of, your skills are probably better suited to waiting and providing a sort of wrap-up or analysis or context, because that is important. And in fact, it's arguably more important than it has ever been, because there's too much information. I feel it, and I know if I feel it, I'm sure lots of other people have been feeling it. So there is still value in that sort of 6 o'clock news, you know, morning newspaper, here's what happened and why you should care and what it means. In fact, that's actually one of my favorite kinds of journalism. And the value of that is increasing, not decreasing. So I think particularly if you're a media entity with, you don't have unlimited resources, maybe you've had to downsize, you know, for business reasons, you have to pick one of those things. Either you're going to do the streaming, real-time, fast, you know, multiple updates approach, or you're just going to wait and do the other. But again, if you wait, the longer you wait, the better it has to be. So it used to be you could come out with something tomorrow or the next day or maybe a week from now. Do you remember a magazine called Newsweek? It used to exist, not anymore. Time doesn't really, well, kind of still around, but that used to be a valuable function. A week later, well, that might as well be 10 years from now. you know, in internet time. So the bar has just been raised. Tomorrow morning is like a week from now. So it had better be pretty good.
Thank you. I work in the old media, at La Stampa. We're trying to transition, of course, to survive to the new media.
Mm-hmm.
And as we know that we should break the territory, break the ground without looking for role models. Of course, we look for role models. So I'm asking you, if you had a gun at your head and you had to choose in the old media, which newspaper is actually transitioning well to the digital new media, which ones would you suggest we should look at?
Hmm. Another good question. I think it really depends on what you want to do, because there are good examples of, I mean, the Huffington Post is a good example of doing one thing. They aggregate very well, and they've actually started producing their own journalism as well. The New York Times is a great example of one model, which is a paywall. But also lots of investment in new media. So they have a huge team, a huge research lab. They're constantly trying new things, new designs, you know, like Snowfall, for example. The only problem is there's only one New York Times, and they have, relatively speaking, a huge amount of resources that other newspapers will never have. So you may want to do that, but it just isn't, you just can't. So then there are two other models. The Guardian is a great model if what you want is to be as open as possible. That is Alan Rusbridger's whole vision. That's what they do. They may have sort of membership-only things, but they will never have a traditional paywall. And they open up as much as possible to, they just released an app called Guardian Witness, which I think is fascinating, to allow readers to help them do the stories that they want to do. They're one of the few that are sort of trying those types of things repeatedly. Another model would be the Daily Mail. The Daily Mail, I think at one point, had the highest traffic of any news entity online, higher than the New York Times. They do that primarily by being a sort of tabloid newspaper. You know, they have these BuzzFeed-style stories that you just have to click on, even though part of you feels like you should have a shower afterwards. That's one model. So they're betting on just traffic, just massive amounts of web traffic. So I think there's, you need to decide, I guess, or pick a model and then just focus on that. Yeah.
What do you think about the guy, the columnist that used to work for the Daily Beast, I don't remember the name right now.
Andrew Sullivan.
Yes, Andrew yeah. Sullivan. But he went away and founded mm-hmm. his own site and so on.
Yeah.
And do you think it's something interesting? It's
very interesting.
Yeah.
He was at a conference that I put on in New York, well, we put on, but he was on a panel about different business models. So Andrew Ross Sorkin, who's a very talented writer, still works for the New York Times and has a whole sort of team within the New York Times. Andrew Sullivan decided to leave traditional media and set up his own thing. And I'm watching it, and I know I'll bet lots of other people, journalists and non-journalists, are watching it very closely, because if he can make that work, then it raises the potential, at least, that other people can make it work. Running something like that yourself, and the fundamental passion that drives Andrew is all he wants is a relationship with his readers. He doesn't want anyone else in between. He doesn't want the New York Times in between. He doesn't want Tina Brown and the Daily Beast in between. He just wants him and his readers and his writing. And so the purity of that relationship is what is appealing. He will succeed or fail based on his ability to connect with this passionate group of readers and convince them to support him. And so, I mean, the jury is still out whether that is going to work or not. But I know, to me, that is one of the things that the web and social media and all of those things allow that was never possible before. Yes. I mean, Andrew would never have his own newspaper. Well, maybe he would have. But, and in fact, if you go back far enough, we talked about history, if you go back far enough, newspapers themselves started as sort of blogs. You know, a wealthy person decided to start a newspaper so they could talk about all the issues that they thought were important. We're really just getting back to that same idea. Was there a question back there? Yeah.
Is this me? Okay.
Yeah.
Hey, Matthew, how you doing? I'm Eric Harvin. I'm the social media editor.
Hi, Eric.
At the Associated Press. Matthew knows me. So I was actually going to ask the same question about examples of doing these things well from old media, but the other part of my question was going to be that obviously all of what we consider old media and old media organizations have a significant digital operation of some kind, and some of them are following some of those rules. Do you think some of the education and learning these sorts of things needs to happen internally? Do you think that within these organizations there's a little bit of a struggle that has emerged, or maybe putting it another way, that the folks who know the digital need to bring things back to the folks on the other side?
I think there's definitely a need. I mean, I know you probably feel this intensely being in the job that you are at Associated Press. There's a huge need for people like you and your brother Andy to help traditional media. I hate using the word old media because, of course, I'm old as well. But I think it would be too bad if there was sort of traditional media over here struggling and trying to do things, and then new media over here doing their own things, and no kind of back and forth. One of the things I talked to Andrew about was, didn't he feel a responsibility in a way to stay inside a traditional media entity and help them? I felt the same thing when I decided to leave the newspaper I worked for. Someone said, well, why don't you stick around and help us figure things out instead of just, you know, bogging off and going with some new thing? And that I felt, you know, to some extent they were right. There is a need for skills that aren't in place in newspapers. And one of the biggest challenges for traditional media entities of all kinds is hanging on to those people or attracting those people. I knew dozens of people like me who just got frustrated and left. And so if all the people who are innovative or creative, and I'm not talking about myself, but if all of those people leave, who's left? You know, all the people waiting till their pension kicks in and clocking out at 5, you know, so those aren't the people who are going to help you innovate. And I think attracting those people and making it appealing for them to help you is one of the challenges. Thanks. Oh, sorry, there's one.
Salve. Volevo parlare della cosa numero 5. Della sua cosa numero 5. Focus o concentrarsi su qualcosa che è molto un trucco, la velocità, come la brevità. E comunque complimenti, perché il fuso non lo sta avvertendo per niente.
Thank you. Thank you. Noam Chomsky thinks everything is a trick. So I don't know. I will say, though, that hyperlocal, to me, is one of the areas where any kind of media, traditional or non-traditional, has a real potential to find a market or to serve a market. So I wrote something recently about what I call, and I don't know if anybody else uses this term, the barbell effect with newspapers in particular. So if you're the New York Times or the Wall Street Journal or the Financial Times, you're probably going to be okay. You know, you're going to figure out the whole digital thing. People will pay you for your content. You're huge. You know, you have this gigantic globe-spanning audience, so you're probably going to be fine. And I actually think that the smaller you are, the better off you'll probably be as well, because particularly in small towns and villages, whether it's in Italy or in North America, there aren't a lot of sources. You know, Google isn't there. There's probably not a lot of local bloggers. Maybe there's one. So the desire, the need for information is still there. And that's where newspapers came from. Every tiny little town had their own newspaper. In some cases, they had multiple newspapers. Boston, I remember reading in the early days of newspapers, had 10 daily newspapers. In a city the size of, is it 300,000 people? 10 daily newspapers. So I think the potential is there because your market is so unique. And if you can form a relationship with them around that information that they need, whether it's the hours of mass or whatever, their local council, then you can, that can be valuable. It's everything in between that is difficult to justify. So if you're a medium-sized metro newspaper, I don't know what the comparison would be in Italy, but the Chicago Tribune, the Philadelphia Inquirer, you have a really, really hard job because you're not local enough or hyper-local enough to be, yeah, you're not small enough, but you're not big enough. You're kind of in between. That's a very difficult place to be.
Hi. In a recent post about Boston bombings and related mistakes, you said that breaking news are messy because real life is messy. So if news are a process and they are a process, should we get used to a messy journalism? Should we surrender to be no more mainstream but only part of the stream?
To me, we have to get used to it because it's just a reality. It just is the way things are. And it's, if anything, it's probably going to get worse, not better. So, we saw things started getting messy when CNN came along, and it was 24 hours. 24 hours, 7 days a week, just constant bombardment of information. And now it's every minute of every day. There's so much information, and you have no idea, is it right, is it wrong? The things like the Boston bombing really crystallize how little we know when those things are happening. And one of the things that I thought was an actual benefit was it makes it obvious what used to be hidden. So all of that chaos and messiness and uncertainty used to exist only in newsrooms. It existed outside in the world too, but in terms of journalism, in terms of making sense of the news, it was something editors did behind the scenes. And they would argue and, you know, is this true? Is this not true? Should we publish that photo? Should we not publish that photo? Is this source credible or not? And it was just making things up as you go along. That's the sausage making process. Now, that happens out in public view everywhere. And so you could argue that's bad because it used to be better when editors would just control the flow of information and then they would tell you what was right and what was wrong, except they got stuff wrong all the time. You know, it wasn't as though they were any more, you know, good at that than, say, you or anybody else. It's just that they were the only ones who could do that. So now we see that chaos and we see the messiness that used to be hidden. And I actually think that's better because now we start to question more. At least I hope we do. I'm hoping people will become more used to thinking, is this right or is this wrong? Whereas in the past, you would read it in a newspaper. I know my mother, for example, would think everything in the newspaper was right. Otherwise, why would they put it in there? Yeah, that's their whole job. But so she was not very questioning. And there are lots of people who are prepared to take the word of sort of traditional journalists as gospel. I think that's actually a mistake. And I wish people would do more questioning. So if the more we get used to that environment, I think stuff will be, in a way, we'll be worse off because we won't run half the time. But you know what? We don't really know what was going on.
Your eye like a big pizza pie that's some more. piece of pie that's amore. your eye like a big pizza pie, that's amore.
To walk comes from a conversation I had with an editor of mine when I worked at a newspaper, and I told him, you know, all we really need to do is evolve and change the way we're doing things. And he said, evolve, you mean like fish grew legs? And so I said, yes, exactly. We just need to teach our fish how to walk, which as it turns out to be harder than you might think. So the first thing I think old media can learn from new media is how to be open. And by that I mean, to a lot of people, I think that traditional media, whether it's newspapers or magazines or television, looks a lot like this. It's a very nice building, but it's a fortress. So it has huge high walls, nothing much gets in, people behind those walls are doing things, you're not too sure what they're doing. Periodically something comes out from the main door, you never see anyone. That's sort of a typical metaphor for what newspapers used to look like and to some extent still look like. Impenetrable, inhuman. I think to a lot of other people, traditional media looks like this, and I realize this looks very much like what I'm doing right now, which is awkward. But so this is another view of what media used to do. Delivering a message from on high, preaching, if you will. We talk, you listen, and that's what media consists of. I think for the most part there hasn't really been much back and forth between journalists and their audience. And I think that's been a result of the way that media was structured. It's very difficult to respond to a newspaper article unless you own your own newspaper. You can call the switchboard, you can grab someone as they walk out, and that's about the only feedback you get. But I think now we have so many more ways of interacting as journalists. Obviously, there's new social tools coming up every day. This is an old version of my social graph. I think my friend Luca Conti might even be in here somewhere. This was from a number of years ago. But we have all the tools we want. And I think one of the interesting things Clay Shirky said, one of the things I hate about Clay Shirky is that he comes up with phrases that I wish I had come up with. And so he said, publishing is no longer an industry, it's a button. So everyone now has the ability to publish. They can publish tweets, they can publish Facebook posts, they can publish blogs, they can publish newspapers. And the second thing old media can learn from new media is to give credit. And what do I mean by that? What's the most fundamental aspect of publishing online? I think the most fundamental aspect is the hyperlink. Obviously, HTML and all those tools, that's what allows us to publish online. But this is the fundamental aspect of what publishing what makes publishing online different from publishing in print. You can't put a link in a print article. And I think the nature of the link is it allows you to give credit to the people who provided information that you are using in your story or your journalism. And it also allows you to support your argument. I actually have as an old time journalist, print journalist who converted sort of to digital, I now read things, if they don't have links, I start to question that thing. Obviously not if it's in print, but if it's online and there are no links in it, to me it is a lower form of journalism. There has to be at least one link. There has to be at least one thing that writer used in their reporting or a source or some other article that they were reading. There has to be something that they used that they should tell me about. Because what if I want to go and find out more information about that thing? Those are the things that you should be providing inside that story. It supports your argument. It supports your credibility. And particularly, if we're talking about a new multi-directional journalism, if you are using other sources, you have to give credit to those sources. You have to provide them the thing that everyone online needs most, which is links from other places that say, this is valuable. And if we can't give people any of this, then at least we can give them a link. At least we can give them a mention on Twitter, for example. At least we could retweet them. It's a form of gratitude, in a way, because we all rely on other people, other information that we found. Nothing comes purely from our own brains. And I think providing credit allows us to show that. So it's a simple thing. I think we forget about the power of links. But we can't operate like a walled garden. We can't pretend that all the things we generate inside that impenetrable fortress are the only things that are of value. And I think this is something that it was a fight. It's becoming less of a fight. But I used to have to...
Buongiorno a tutti. Sono Claudio Giua, sono il direttore dello sviluppo e innovazione del Gruppo Espresso. E per me è un grande onore oggi brevissimamente introdurre Matthew Ingram. Matthew Ingram è uno dei giornalisti che riescono a fare del futuro un panorama che diventa, come dire, per tutti noi comprensibile ed accettabile. Matthew Ingram ha cominciato come giornalista economico, ha lavorato in vari giornali di varie dimensioni in Canada, è canadese, vive a Toronto. Dopo molti anni di questo lavoro, all'inizio del nuovo millennio, cioè una dozzina di anni fa, è passato a lavorare al sito del Globe and Mail, che è il più importante giornale in lingua inglese canadese. Lì ha cominciato a trattare, non solo dal punto di vista del sito, ma anche scrivendo sui giornali, di problemi legati al web, al digitale, eccetera, e è diventato in pochi anni una delle voci più importanti, secondo me, secondo il mio giudizio, la più importante voce di analisi e di comprensione, che ci consente la comprensione dei fenomeni. Personalmente è proprio un giornalista di una categoria che mi fa, come dire, arrabbiare, perché mi capita spesso che mentre io ancora sto cercando di formulare le mie domande, cercare di capire quale domande fare per capire il fenomeno, Matthew se ne esca con un articolo dove mi dà già le risposte. Questo ovviamente ti fa sentire un po' stupido, perché dice, ma come, io ancora devo capire dove siamo e lui già mi dà la risposta che mi fa andare così avanti. E questo lo fa oggi per un importantissimo sito che forse voi conoscete, che si chiama GigaOM, che è stato fondato alcuni anni fa da O'Malik e che adesso, ha qualche tempo fa, ha anche inglobato un altro sito molto importante, che è Paid Content. Quindi se voi andate su paidcontent.com o gigaom.com trovate tutti i suoi articoli che sono sotto il suo nome, li trovate tutti riuniti. E tra questi troverete, per esempio, mi sono segnato alcuni degli ultimi articoli che ha scritto negli ultimi giorni. È molto prolifico Matthew, anzi. Mi raccontava prima che recentemente un suo amico e collega gli ha detto mi metti in difficoltà perché scrivi troppo spesso e scrivi troppe cose e io devo leggere tutte perché sono obbligato a leggere per capire qualcosa, e probabilmente se tu allentassi un po' il ritmo sarebbe meglio. Ha scritto delle cose che a me particolarmente interessano molto, in particolare ha scritto un articolo molto importante qualche giorno fa sul fenomeno del cosiddetto brand journalism, cioè il giornalismo che è legato direttamente alle aziende e che sta probabilmente creerà nei prossimi anni il maggior numero di posti di lavoro anche per i giornalisti. Quindi lo dico ai molti ragazzi che sono qui che vogliono fare questo mestiere, perché il brand journalism non è niente di vergognoso, non vuol dire fare un lavoro dalla parte dei brand, dalla parte delle aziende, vuol dire fare informazione semplicemente, anziché farlo per organismi, chiamiamoli indipendenti, viene fatto direttamente dalle aziende, ma questo non vuol dire che non possa essere un giornalismo di buona qualità a tutti gli effetti. Questi e tanti altri argomenti sono il pane quotidiano di Matthew, quindi io lascerei immediatamente la parola a lui ha una presentazione credo molto visuale. Quello che è importante è che alla fine del suo intervento, perché così si aspetta, me l'ha proprio ripetuto, si aspetta le vostre domande, quindi il più possibile preparatevi domande anche brevissime, Matthew sarà felicissimo di rispondere. Grazie.
Grazie. Grazie. Buongiorno. Good morning. How are you all doing? Good? Those are all the languages I know, by the way. That last one was American. Can you pull up the slide? I'd like to apologize just in advance. I just got here yesterday, and so part of my brain still thinks it's 5:30 in the morning. So if anything goes wrong, just please ignore it or call the authorities or whatever. So I'm going to go through this as quickly as I can, and then hopefully we can get to some questions, because I think that's often the most, you know, I enjoy my slides, but I think questions are often the best part of a presentation. So I'm going to go as quickly as I can. So the first thing I think, and I should note, this presentation is called Five Things Old Media Can Learn from New Media. Obviously, there are things that new media can learn from old media as well, but that's a whole different presentation. So, and the subtitle, How to Teach the Fish They Can Publish Whatever They Want. Those tools are no longer ours alone as journalists, and that fundamentally changes the relationship. I think all we have to do if we want to improve our journalism is to ask people for help. We have so many tools now, and those tools aren't just for transmitting our journalism. They aren't just for promoting our content. They're for interaction. And my test for what a journalist is doing now is how much of that interaction they do. And the less they do, I think the poorer journalist they are. That's my belief. I think lots of times people will provide things that you could never imagine. This is my favorite graphic for Twitter. Twitter obviously is only one tool. There are lots of other ways to get feedback from people. And I think everyone wants to feel like they have something to contribute. Everyone wants to feel like they have something that they can offer. And in many cases, they do. These people are what Dan Gilmore called the people formerly known as the audience. So in the past, the audience was much like you are here, sitting, listening, receiving. But that audience has become has the ability now to interact and publish along with journalists. And I think that changes the nature of that relationship to multi-directional instead of just unidirectional. Sometimes people know things that we don't know, things that are useful, things that are important. How do we help them tell us those things? How many ways can we give them to let us know the things that they know about the stories we're writing? That, to me, is the core of what these tools allow. They allow you to do better journalism by contacting people who know things you don't. And that's the fundamental problem of journalism. You're writing about something, you need to know something. There is someone out there who knows that thing. And this is a way for you to find them. So number one, be more open. This is a quote from Alan Rusbridger, the editor-in-chief of The Guardian, and he described his view of open journalism, a journalism that is itself responsive, a journalism that doesn't just sit on the web as though there's no connection with the web. And you can produce better things by not ignoring it and by not building a barrier between yourself and that. And obviously there's a fundamental tension here, which maybe we can talk later, Claudio and I and you, about the tension between that vision of open journalism and paywalls, because there's quite clearly a tension there. So the first thing is to be open.